So as we talk about the panel itself, just want to show you the report. There are five different markers, and actually there are four targets in the brain, and those four and in the nervous system. The other is actually a stimulation assay. It's involved with growing up human neuronal cells in culture and then incubating the serum of a patient on these human neuronal cells and then pulse chasing them with P32. And the reason that we do that is because the enzyme called CAM kinase is involved in a high order regulation of cell plasticity, but the other is it also upregulates the synthesis of three neurotransmitters, dopamine, epinephrine, and norepinephrine. I'll go through some of the different tests and talk a little bit about the biologic function. There's actually five different, at least known, five different dopamine receptors. And the D1 and D2 are highly concentrated in pre- and postsynaptic neurons in the brain. And we use a specific kind, and we look for them, and we use them in targeted assays and look for serum antibodies that cross a threshold upon a certain baseline normal level. What we find also is that not only do they just bind to them, but they can act as agonist or antagonist. And so a patient that might have an antibody against dopamine D2, for instance, it's not just that it's the antibody against dopamine D2. It could act and bind to it, but may not impede its function. It can act and bind to it and actually act as an agonist, meaning it functions as if it was dopamine because it binds into the active site of the receptor, or it acts as an antagonist and it binds and it blocks the function of the receptor, so dopamine can't be utilized properly. And we see this the case in patients. We don't do that assay in the clinical lab because it's too tedious and would cost too much. But in the research side, we're able to identify that this is the case. And so one of the sort of surrogates is, does it bind to D2 or D1? Because you really don't want to see high titers against those particular proteins in your body. Tubulin used to be just thought of as sort of a biological bystander, but it is now known that tubulin plays an important role in cell signaling, communication within the cell and the brain. And in fact, studies have been done that if you look at mutations or deletions in certain parts of the tubulin, that you can also see that you end up with OCD, cognitive impairment, different types of symptoms, and you can see all of these different symptoms in patients that have genetic mutations in the tubulin gene. So what we find is it's not only highly concentrated in the brain, but it also plays more than a role than just scaffolding in a cell, which is what originally was thought of. But it's involved in meiosis and mitosis. It's involved in other functions of the cell. So it's an integral function and a protein that if it's disrupted, and you can see these tubules, they're made of alpha and beta subunits, that they self-assemble. And in order for them to self-assemble to do their function, they have to be able to recognize each other. So if antibodies are interfering with the self-recognition, then you can see differences in their ability to be able to self-assemble. And you can see in the neuron slide that these are antibody staining tubulin, and you can see them in the neuronal cells. Lysoganglioside in particular, GM1, because lysoganglioside, there are many different kinds. Some of them are around the myelin sheath. And as you can see, it's a carbohydrate function with also a moiety at the end. And again, I mentioned that Guillain-Barré syndrome is also one that has anti-lysogangliosides. But it has a biological function to insulate the nerve pathway. And so as a nerve impulse goes down through from nerve to nerve, it has to be insulated, kind of like an insulation around a copper wire. If you remove the insulation from a copper wire, you don't get faithful transmission of the electrical current because it gets dissipated. It's one of the thoughts of how this actually happens in other types of similar disorders that attack the myelin sheath. You can think of multiple sclerosis and other types of conditions, and they affect different types of movement. And then last, as I mentioned, the CAM kinase, these antibodies, it's now being more understood that this enzyme is very critical. If I showed you the pathway up here, it looked like a Los Angeles freeway. So there's all kinds of different interactions with this enzyme, and it's responsible for many different functions. And as you can see here in both Sydenham, Korea, and PANDAS patients, that they're elevated but at different levels. And so what we find also from genetic studies in these two papers, the one of American Journal of Human Genetics and in this other paper, in loss of function mutations in a CAM gene, which would translate to an inefficient or dysfunctional enzyme. And you see here what they say is variants in the latter genes may cause, intellectual disability, infantile epileptic encephalopathy, epileptic aphasia, or be associated with Tourette syndrome, schizophrenia, or autism. Functional studies performed in this study suggest that CAM2A and 2B, these are two subsets, may be involved in a broad range of neurologic and psychiatric disorders.